All right, this meeting is hereby called to order. The time is 6:00 PM. Today's date is September 26, 2016. This special meeting is called for the purpose of holding a public hearing to consider the petition for detachment from Fort Bend Independent School District and annexation to Alvin Independent School District submitted by the residents of the Village of Diamond Bay subdivision of Shadow Creek Ranch pursuant to Texas Education Code Section 13.051. The board members present are Mr. Ke-
Jim Rice.
Jason Verdeen.
Kristen Tossin.
Addie Helliger.
Grail James.
Dave Rosenthal.
And for the record, would the petitioner's representatives please identify themselves?
Keisha LeBlanc.
Heather Zias.
Kobe Earls.
Nicole Stotler.
Tashia Jameson.
Simone N.
Thank you. And would the members of the administration please identify themselves for the record?
Kobe Wilbanks.
Steve Bassett.
Kristi Whitbeck.
Thank you. Texas law requires that the petitioner satisfy five threshold requirements to establish a valid petition. Number one, the territory that is the subject of the detachment request must be contiguous to the district to which the petitioners seek annexation. Number two, the petition must be signed by a majority of the registered voters residing in the territory to be detached and annexed. Number three, the petition must include a meets and bounds description of the territory to be detached and annexed. Number four, the detachment must not cause the district from which property is proposed to be detached to be reduced to an area of less than 9 square miles. And number five, the proposed detachment must satisfy a tax-based ratio analysis that is designed to ensure that the district from which the property is proposed to be detached does not experience a disproportionate loss of revenue in the detachment. In addition to these five requirements, the board must consider the educational interests of current and future students in the affected territory and in the remainder of the district, as well as the social and economic effects of the proposed detachment. A recording is being made of this hearing. Please avoid speaking when others are speaking so the recording will accurately capture the proceedings. This hearing is not a trial and no formal rules of evidence or procedure will apply. Each side is allowed 30 minutes to make its presentation. The petitioners will be permitted to make their presentation first and the administration will then respond. After the presentations are completed, the board will hear public comment. The board has allotted 30 minutes for public comment in support of detachment and 30 minutes for public comment in opposition to detachment. Persons wishing to speak are required to sign in, and I assume that that has been done, completed, and each speaker will be permitted to speak for 3 minutes. Following public comment, the party's representatives will each be permitted to make a 5-minute closing argument. Board members are not to be questioned in any manner by either side. Following the presentations, however, the board members may ask questions if they desire. The petitioners may now make their presentation. You have a total of 30 minutes. Our board secretary, Ms. Helliger, will keep time for us, and she will give you a 2-minute warning before your time expires.
Can you hear me? Good evening. My name is Heather Zias, and I'm a resident of the Village of Diamond Bay and Shadow Creek Ranch. By day, I'm a project manager for an engineering and construction firm. By life, I'm a wife, and I'm a mother of a rambunctious, soon-to-be 5-year-old. I'm joined this evening by many fellow residents, but I'm going to point out Terry Earls, Shia Jameson, Nicole Stotler, Keisha LeBlanc, and Sarome N., and they will be joining me in the presentation this evening. Fort Bend is allotted, as you mentioned. We have 30 minutes for our presentation. Chairwoman and trustees, we will do our very best to stay within that time frame. We would greatly appreciate it if we reach the 30-minute mark and have not concluded that you please allow us the time needed to finish this very important topic and presentation. We have provided you with a packet of supplemental information, including emails exchanged between our organizations. We've also included a resolution passed by the city of Pearland in support of our efforts to unite our community through this petition. We've provided, our petition was submitted April 8th, 2016, and it included a cover letter with an open records request for critical pieces of information for our petition. By law, the district has generally 10 days to respond or request an attorney general ruling on whether the information can be withheld. We were initially advised by Fort Bend on May 6th that the data and records we requested were not maintained in the district. This includes such things as student counts. Then, on the evening of September 21st, 5.5 months after our initial request and 5 days before our hearing, Fort Bend provided 90 pages of documentation. A copy of this packet has been provided for your convenience. We asked in our cover letter that the information requested be provided 3 to 4 weeks prior to the scheduled hearing date in order to minimize conflicting data, and so that a complete and accurate picture could be presented to you, the trustees, and to assure effective and efficient use of everyone's time. Just this morning, Fort Bend ISD sent over new data, only to replace it again later in the afternoon, and approximately an hour and a half before the start of this hearing, we received yet again new data. Changes from the initial data were not redlined or otherwise indicated. It's important that the trustees have a clear picture, so during our presentation, we will do our very best to attempt to address as many data discrepancies as we can within the time frame established. So again, we would appreciate your consideration if additional time is necessary. Our petition was based on Texas Education Code 13.051, Detachment and Annexation, referred to as the code. And it serves as a legal basis and authority. I'm sorry, our presentation isn't running. Somebody was said they would start it. Can you? Yeah, that's good.
Just so that it's clear, we paused your time while you were getting your.
Appreciate that. Excuse me. The code serves as a legal basis and authority for this petition. The primary purpose of the code is to give residents of a territory a say where their children will attend school. We feel this is best exemplified in the Green Tea Association versus Galveston County Commissioner's Appeal, which states, prior decisions of the commissioner in cases of this sort have established the following principles. One, detachment and annexation provided by the code was intended by the legislature to allow a majority of the residents of a territory to determine, within certain constraints, which school district their children will attend. Two, the residents of an area sought to be detached from one district and annexed to another are in a better position than the legislature to know which school district is best suited for the needs of their children. Three, petitions which meet the technical requirements of the statute should be viewed favorably in the absence of significant, even compelling reason not to do so. The technical requirements of the code include that a territory may not be detached, that a territory may not be detached from a school district and annexed to another school district that is contiguous to the detached territory. The Village of Diamond Bay is contiguous. Additionally, the code states that the petition for detachment and annexation must be signed by a majority of the voters residing in the territory. In our position, we present evidence demonstrating we have met this requirement with 61% of our registered voters signing the petition. And the last date we pulled our registered voter information was March 3rd, 2016. The petition must give the meets and bounds of the territory. The meets and bounds were presented under Exhibit 4A in our petition. A school district may not reduce the area by less than 9 miles or to an area of less than 9 miles. The removal of the Village of Diamond Bay will result in reduction of less than 1 square mile, leaving Fort Bend at approximately 169 square miles. A school district may not be, and the detachment may not reduce the district's tax base by a ratio at least twice as large as the ratio by which it would reduce its membership. As presented in our petition, we also meet this requirement, but we will cover in more detail later in the presentation. The detaching district can vote to waive the ratio as well. The code continues that at each hearing, affected persons are entitled to an opportunity to be heard. Fort Bend ISD has limited our affected person speaking in favor of the petition to 25 minutes. Assuming a person speaks for the customary 3 minutes, this time constraint would only allow 8 of our affected persons from a neighborhood of more than 1,600 plus homes to be heard. We requested that Fort Bend allow ample time for all affected persons to voice their opinion. However, our request to date has not been granted. During the hearing and at the conclusion of the hearing, the code requires that each Board of Trustees consider the educational interest of the current students residing in the territory or future students expected to reside in the affected territory and in the affected districts, and the social, economic, and educational effects of the proposed boundary change, and shall, on a basis of those findings, adopt a resolution approving or disapproving the petition. The Supreme Court of Texas has held that in the eyes of the law, there is no hearing unless a fair opportunity is afforded the parties to prove their case before an administrative agency. Furthermore, a hearing is unfair when the decision makers have made up their minds before the hearing. In the education law context, as applied in Northgate Forest Petitioners versus Spring ISD, the courts have found that a board cannot determine its decision prior to holding a statutorily required hearing. Fundamental fairness dictates that a person must be given the opportunity to be heard on merits of the dispute at a meaningful time and in a meaningful manner. If both boards of trustees of the affected districts approve the petition, the commissioner's court shall enter an order redefining the boundaries of the districts. If both boards of trustees disapprove the petition, the decisions may not be appealed and another petition submitted for 3 years. However, an appeal is allowed for an unfair hearing as defined in the Texas Education Code. If the Board of Trustees of only one district disapproves the petition, an aggrieved party to the proceedings may appeal the board's decision to the commissioner as allowed under Section 7.057. This evening, we will demonstrate that we have met all of the technical requirements required by the code and that the educational interests, along with the social, financial, and educational effects of detachment from Fort Bend ISD and annexation into Alvin ISD is not only warranted, but is demanded.
In the interest of time, I'm going to ask that the audience refrain from applauding just so that we can give the petitioners all of their time. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Terry Earls. I'm going to present the social effects as they relate to the current and future students currently zoned to Blue Ridge Elementary, McCullough Middle School, and Willow Ridge High School. Children living in the Shadow Creek Ranch community who are zoned to the Alvin ISD schools have the opportunity to bike or walk to school given their close proximity to each school. They also have the opportunity to carpool with friends and neighbors, a luxury to which our children have not been afforded. 52 out of the 74 children currently attending the 3 Fort Bend ISD zone schools take the bus, which requires some of them to be up and prepared to get on the bus by 6:15 a.m. These travel times are increased due to an active railroad at the intersection of Alameda Road and Shadow Creek Parkway, otherwise known as 2234. We also have various industrial and chemical companies that continue along Alameda, for which employees and delivery trucks continually arrive and depart. It is also notable to point out that we have increased travel time for those who travel via the bus. Our children who travel by bus spend approximately 23 to 43 minutes on the bus to and from school. If our children were annexed into Alvin ISD, they would be able to use all three of the options listed in the table as a means of transporting themselves to and from school each day. We would see an average reduction of 31.2% travel time for those that travel by car, a 48% reduction for those traveling by bicycle, and a 49.6% reduction for those who prefer to walk to school. This comparative analysis was performed using Google Maps and a centrally located address within the Village of Diamond Bay section of Shadow Creek Ranch. As you can see, we have an active railroad, industrial traffic, and the absence of sidewalks, which add an additional safety component for those commuting to each of the three zone schools, thus rendering the option to walk or even bike moot. The last point I would like for you to consider is the significant number of sexual offenders that are located in close proximity to the Fort Bend ISD schools. And this map that I have up now speaks volumes to the vast difference in the amount of registered sexual offenders noted near the Fort Bend ISD schools versus the Alvin ISD schools. We included research in our original petition, which included the health impacts on longer commute time. It illustrated that adolescents with a longer morning commute often suffer from a decline in academic performance. They were noted to have an increase in being overweight or suffering from depression. They are also more likely to be involved in auto accidents due to drowsy driving. Longer distances between home and school are particularly disadvantageous to students who forget their homework, lunch money, or miss the bus. If children miss the bus for any reasons, parents are left attempting to chase the buses down to catch them before the last stop or otherwise drive out to the schools. For parents, unexpected drives out to Fort Bend ISD schools can pose challenges for those trying to get to work on time. Children attending schools located far from their neighborhoods are known to be alienated from their peer groups with whom they only interact with at school functions. As we all know, their social lives revolve around school activities and friends at school. The locations of some of the schools attended by our children also decreases their chance of developing close or permanent relationships. Lastly, increased commute time decreases study time, which can negatively impact our children's academic performance in school. The 2016-2017 school year brought a huge change to the district's transfer policy. Children were only allowed to transfer from their zone school if they met the requirements listed on this slide. Some of the obstacles presented to transfer students include the need to reapply at each transition grade, as well as find transportation to these schools, as Fort Bend does not provide transportation for those who are on the transfer list. It is also good to note that sibling transfers are not guaranteed, which poses another problem for families with multiple children. These are the schools to which the remainder of the 74 children currently enrolled in Fort Bend ISD schools attend. As you can see, there would be a significant reduction in travel time for those who attend Fort Bend ISD elementary schools. I do need to add, if I may, my personal travel analysis, as my children and many others were not captured in the data provided by the district. I have four children who attend three different schools outside the district. Three are in private school, and one is in a school for children with special needs. If we were to be zoned to Alvin ISD schools, our commute time would be reduced by at least 73% if we were allowed to attend the schools in our neighborhood. So you asked, what are the effects of annexation? For those who live within the Shadow Creek subdivision, we'd have a reduced commute time. It will allow our children time to sleep adequately. It would alleviate some of the economic strain for those of us who do have children in private schools outside the district. It would allow increased participation in extracurricular activities. Our children would also have the ability to walk or bike to and from school. It would connect our children with the remainder of Shadow Creek, as well as connect our families to other residents in the city of Pearland. All right, thank you.
Sorry. Hi, my name is Tashia Jameson, and I'm talking about the educational effects of our annexation. So we're going to look at the academic comparisons. I want you to take a look at the high school and middle school information, and I'm also going to go to the next school year. There is a significant difference in an academic gap between the zoned Fort Bend ISD schools and the Alvin ISD schools. Just because the state gives the bottom floor requirements doesn't mean these scores at Blue Ridge, McAuliffe, and Willow Ridge are acceptable. We have high expectations for our kids and their future, and just because the state says the school has met the standards, you all know that these schools are far from where we want and need them to be for our kids. The PEG program is a funding program which identifies campuses with pass rates on the STAR that are less or than equal to 50% in any two of the three preceding years or were rated improvement acquired in the previous 3 years. Fort Bend ISD has went from 3 schools to 7 schools. 2 of our schools are on that list, McAuliffe Middle School and Willow Ridge High School. The TEA requires that PEG schools to communicate to our parents by February 1st, 2016 about possible transfer information to other Fort Bend schools, and we have not heard anything from Fort Bend ISD. We don't hear anything from you all about bond meetings, zoning, or community town halls. Children at Risk is an organization that strives to serve as an accessible guide for parents, educators, and community members on the performance of local schools and spark important community dialogue on the quality of public education in Texas. They rank and grade schools, all schools in Texas. These factors determine the grading and ranking: Student Achievement Index, Campus Performance Index, Growth Index, and College Readiness Index. Merrick Elementary, which is the Alvin ISD school, is ranked 188th out of 4,188 schools in elementary schools in Texas. They are in the top 5% in the state. They have an A-plus grade. York Elementary School is ranked 779th. They're in the top 20% in the state, A-minus grade. Wilder Ingalls Elementary, ranked 158th in the state, top 4% in the state, A-plus grade. Blue Ridge Elementary, ranked 3,109th. Out of 4,188 total elementary schools in Texas. They're in the bottom 25% in the state. They have a D grade. The middle schools, Nolan Ryan is Alvin ISD school. They are ranked 207th, top 15% in the state, an A grade. McAuliffe Middle School ranked 1,596. Out of 1,670 total middle schools in Texas. They're in the bottom 5% in the state, F grade. Manville High School, which is Alvin ISD, ranked 530th out of the state of Texas for high schools. It's in the average, about 45%, C-plus grade, but this will not be our high school. Our high school would be Shadow Creek Ranch High School. But Willow Ridge High School ranked 1,058 in the state out of 1,159 total Texas high schools, bottom 8% in the state, F grade. As you can see, Blue Ridge and Willow Ridge have met the standard, but this is not indicative of the educational experience that our kids are or would be receiving. According to this ranking system, these schools are poor performing. McAuliffe is improvements required school. Fort Bend ISD has tried many programs to curb the behavioral issues because this is such a problem for the schools that we are zoned to. Classroom environments affect student performance and is not measured separately for state accountability rankings, one article said. Parents feel as if their children were struggling to stay on course because the teacher devotes more time to managing disruptive or insubordinate students. That was a parent that came to your Fort Bend ISD board meeting on December 7th, 2015. Classroom management. This chart shows the behavior issues that are in our zone schools. In 2014 to 2015, McAuliffe Middle School has unequivocal behavior issues that are not matched by any other school in your district. McAuliffe has had 172 incidences, and the next school that is close was Missouri City Middle School, with 92 behavior incidences. McAuliffe alone had 135 fights, almost double the next school, which is 73 fights at Lake Olympia. In 2014 to 2015, Willow Ridge has had 90 incidences with behavior. The closest number to that number is 74, and that's Elkins High School. These all affect the effective learning environment in which our children could reach their teachers' expectations with mastery. It is nearly impossible to provide a great educational experience if the classroom management is not implemented effectively. As you can see, these are some of the programs that you offer the schools in Fort Bend ISD. Now, Blue Ridge doesn't provide many programs for our children. Since children learn the most in the first 7 years of their life, the fact that Blue Ridge doesn't have any academic programs or extracurricular activities that provide academic stimulation and rigor that can carry over to the classroom, while Alvin ISD has many programs like robotics that could have academic focus that would carry over into the classroom, building several different kinds of intelligences, which would eventually lead to higher testing because our kids are being challenged on many levels. What are our options? We could send our kids to private school, but we worked so hard to get to a neighborhood like Shadow Creek Ranch. Plus, we pay lots of taxes to your district, our district. It is sad that Fort Bend ISD does not have the best interests of our children or our community in mind, and they're not servicing us to the best of its capabilities. And I am a former teacher at a Title I school in HISD in Fifth Ward. I had three housing projects zoned to my elementary school. My former school is ranked above 3,500 out of 4,188 in elementary schools in the state, and is a grade and an F for academic performance this year. My former elementary school and the schools that we're zoned to, and particularly your F grade schools, have many similarities. I have experienced those troubles and inadequacies that all these schools that we're zoned to have been going through. These are not optimal learning environments. The behavior issues that have detrimental effect on students' academic performance. These schools' teachers cannot maximize the academic opportunity with constant behavioral issues.
Good evening. My name is Nicole Stotler, and I am a former resident of the Village of Diamond Bay who recently moved to Southern Trails in Brazoria County, and by day I'm a human resources director for an oil and gas company. I'll be taking some time this evening to speak to the capacity implications within Fort Bend ISD and Alvin ISD. Fort Bend ISD's current enrollments are under capacity for both the middle and high schools. However, we would like to reiterate that these campuses are considered PEG campuses, which means they failed to meet the state standards in recent years. Public data indicates that the elementary school is 120% utilized, which is the maximum utilization rate that Fort Bend ISD's policy allows. It is widely known that capacity challenges exist in several areas within Fort Bend ISD's jurisdiction. Fort Bend ISD has acknowledged in public meetings that it underestimated the projected growth of one of its fastest growing communities, Siena Plantation. Fort Bend ISD also admitted that the firm PASA Demographics that is used to project the growth within the district provided population planning data that did not account for the adequate resource and structural planning by the district officials, and resulted in Fort Bend ISD having to play a vicious game of catch-up, evidenced by the current construction of two elementary schools and a middle school to serve the Siena Plantation community. The same firm was commissioned to perform a population analysis for the Village of Diamond Bay, and we anticipate a similar fate. We respectfully question the accuracy of the data that they have provided and that Fort Bend ISD plans to render decisions on the basis of. This firm has evidenced that it cannot accurately project growth within a community and the associated timing for corresponding educational resources. This ability is critical for rapidly growing communities like the Village of Diamond Bay. Current enrollment for the Alvin ISD schools located in Shadow Creek Ranch is shown on the provided slide. And while the enrollment at each of the elementary schools and the middle school is above the capacity of 800 and 1,000 students respectively, the portable classrooms and additional educational facilities approved in the 2015 bond vote will not only alleviate the overflow from these schools, but it can also provide additional capacity to accommodate the students residing in the Village of Diamond Bay. In the case of Green Tea Association versus Galveston County Commissioners, it was found that the redrawing of boundary lines and the use of portable buildings is an acceptable practice, and Alvin ISD has shown that it is a practice that it is willing to employ to educate its rapidly growing student body.
Good evening. My name is Keisha LeBlanc, and I'm a certified public accountant in the state of Texas. I have spent the majority of my career as an auditor, and I'm a wife and mother of two small children, a four-year-old and a 22-month-old. Fort Bend ISD will present to you this evening evidence to imply that detaching the Village of Diamond Bay from Fort Bend ISD will cause $21 million of debt to be unfunded, will reduce taxable revenue by $3.9 million, and also reduce revenue by an estimated $15 million over a four-year period, and reduce revenue related to attendance by $453,000 related to the 74 students who currently attend Fort Bend ISD from Village of Diamond Bay. And they will also cite the hardship of selling the property that was at the corner of FM 2234 and Trinity Bay that had the sign that said future site of Fort Bend ISD Elementary School. For approximately eight years, that sign was up until we started to mobilize as a community, and then it came down. First of all, it is misleading for the board to present the $21 million related to the debt and the $15 million of revenue loss over the four-year period as if they are two separate amounts, when in fact they are both a function of the $3.9 million of property tax revenue received from the Village of Diamond Bay. This $3.9 million of property tax revenue is only 1% of Fort Bend ISD's total tax property revenue of $386 million. Furthermore, this loss will be offset by increased revenues due to the expansion of new communities on the west side of Fort Bend ISD, which will reduce the amount of unfunded debt and most likely completely replace the loss of our 1% of property tax revenue. The City of Sugarland website states that it is one of the fastest growing cities in Texas. Sugarland's residential real estate market is growing to meet the demands of a developing population. The city boasts numerous communities such as Riverstone, whose estimated property values are $275,000 to a million, Telfair that is $250,000 to $500,000, Harvest Green that starts at $240,000 in the Richmond area. I'd also like to address the $450,000 loss attributed to the 74 Village of Diamond Bay students that would no longer attend Fort Bend ISD schools. In the district's 2015-2016 budget, it calculated an approximate $7,900 cost to educate these students. If these students were to no longer attend Fort Bend ISD schools, this would reduce the cost by $585,000 for the year, which would completely negate the $453,000, making this a non-issue for the district. FBISD currently receives $3.9 million of property tax revenue from Village of Diamond Bay and only educates 74 of our students because of the low academic performance of the schools. This yields a revenue of $52,000 per Village of Diamond Bay student every year and creates a surplus of $44,000 per student. This also creates an annual surplus of $3.3 million per year. With the current state of financial affairs between FBISD and the Village of Diamond Bay, it is much like Great Britain and the colonies prior to the revolution. Taxation without representation, or in this case, taxation without attendance costs. Finally, I'll address the property at the corner of FM 2234 and Trinity Bay.
Thank you, you have reached your time limit.
May we address the ratio, please?
How much time do you think that's gonna take?
That will probably take about 4 minutes.
Yeah, go ahead and do that.
Okay. The final item that I would like to discuss is the racial requirement. The law states a territory that has residents may not be detached from a school district under this section if the detachment will reduce that district's tax base by a ratio at least twice as large as the ratio by which it would reduce its membership. The Village of Diamond Bay assessed property value is $365 million. FBISD's total district's property value is $35 billion. The total number of students is approximately 74,000. This would yield an estimated student population of 385 students for us to meet the ratio requirement. Based on the calculation, the tax basis ratio is 0.01046. And here this slide illustrates a calculation of the ratio in four different ways with four different estimations. The first calculation illustrates Fort Bend ISD's calculation where you've used 120 students and you've just used the students that attend public ISDs. And the law clearly states that you use all student populations, not just students that attend public schools, so that this first calculation is erroneously performed, so this is not a valid calculation. The second calculation is based on PASA demographics calculation through communications with FBISD through an email where they determined that Shadow Creek Ranch is a retirement community. And so used 0.3 students per household, and even with using us as a retirement community, we would still have 414 students, and we would still meet the ratio requirement. And then finally, the third estimate is based on our demographics, where we went door to door in our community that we know the best, and determined that 48% of households have children, have 1.84 children per home, and 54% of those children are school age, which yields about 665 students in the Village of Diamond Bay, which also meets the requirement. And then finally, going back to the communication between PASA demographics and Fort Bend ISD, where they cite Creekmont and other comparable communities having a 0.58 and 0.6 students per household ratio, and calculating that based on the 1,380 occupied homes in the Village of Diamond Bay, that would yield 690 students, which also meets the ratio. And these two last ratios here, these two numbers, are pretty similar, and they were performed independently, one from PASA's 0.58 and 0.6 in an email communication, and the other from our independent demographics that we obtained. And so that would basically mean about 600 students in Village of Diamond Bay yielded from two independent calculations. So it would appear and seem most reasonable that the student population in Village of Diamond Bay is 600 students.
Thank you. Excuse me. It will go faster if I can. So do you guys have a copy of those slides that you can provide to the board members? If you will please provide that to Mrs. Kaiser. Okay, yeah, if you can provide that to Mrs. Kaiser, and she will make copies for the board. Thank you. Okay, the administration may now make its presentation. You will likewise have 34 minutes with a 2-minute warning. Ms. Helliger will keep the time.
Good evening, and thank you, Madam President and board members. My name is Kobe Wilbanks, as we indicated earlier, and I'm an attorney with Fort Bend ISD. Tonight, I'll be presenting the administration's response and recommendation regarding the petition for detachment and annexation. As you've heard, the petitioners are seeking what they feel is in the best interest of their children and their community, and we respect that. In actuality, tonight, your role is very similar. Your role is to evaluate the effects, to evaluate the petition, in terms of what is in the best interest of your students and community. I want to remind you that your students and your community includes the Village of Diamond Bay, but it also includes the other 74,000 students in the district, as well as the community of the district as a whole. As an illustration of this, we have at the back of the room, you see this map. It's a map of the district. For illustration purposes, I want you to see that this red square in the corner is the Village of Diamond Bay. We simply want you to have an understanding of where this property is located, as well as a reminder of your role is for the Village of Diamond Bay, as also for the district as a whole. As referenced by the petitioner, the Education Code provides that we consider one, the statutory requirements for petition and annexation, and then two substantive areas. And for clarification, what I want us to do tonight is these two substantive areas we're going to combine together. The first is the educational interests of current students residing or future students who reside in the affected territory and in the affected districts, and then the social, economic, and educational effects. Again, for clarification purposes, we're going to do as the Commissioner of Education does when he analyzes these type of cases. That first educational interest prong, we're going to combine that with the educational effects prong. What that means is our outline for tonight looks something like this. We're going to begin with the economic effects. We'll move then to the educational interests and effects for this petition, as well as the social effects. And then we'll conclude with the statutory requirements for the evening. As a reminder, the core motivation tonight is what's in the best interest of the children in the community. Again, for you, it's in the best interest of the children of the Village of Diamond Bay, the students, as well as all the students of the district. The difference between the administration's perspective, or the administration's presentation, and the petitioner's presentation is one of perspective. You've heard it said, let's not lose sight of the forest for the trees. And that's a matter of perspective. It's an idea of don't lose sight of, look at the specific focused issues, the trees, if you will, but you also have to take a step back and look at the impact to the forest, in this case, the district as a whole. So what we will do is as we walk through each of these effects, we're gonna look at them from both perspectives. We're gonna look at them from the perspective of the tree, if you will, from the petitioners, from the residents of the Village of Diamond Bay. And we'll also back up and look at them from the district as a whole. Again, we'll conclude with the statutory requirements. Before we begin, we have our roadmap. We want to go ahead and lay out the destination of where the administration's going. Our recommendation, initially, the information and presentation tonight will demonstrate that approval of the petition is not in the best interest of the students, all the students of this district, as well as the community, the district as a whole. So specifically, we recommend that the board disapprove the petition for detachment and annexation. This recommendation is based, again, on these considerations. Let's begin first with the economic effects. You've seen this slide before. The petitioners presented this as well. The initial and most staggering number economic effect is the debt service impact. As you're aware, Fort Bend ISD, our tax rate is built on, we have two pieces to our tax rate. The interest and sinking piece, the debt service piece, is one aspect of that tax rate. That portion of the tax rate generates tax revenue used solely for debt service. And in this case, when you lose the amount of tax base that's in the affected territory of the petition, the impact over the time of that debt service payment is approximately $21 million. We'll note that you had an exhibit in your binder we provided to you tonight. We provided an updated exhibit. In our preparation, we realized that we provided you an earlier draft of that exhibit rather than the final draft. It is behind Exhibit 3. That's page 4 of Exhibit 3, just for your reference. That attachment is the debt service analysis. It walks through between 2017 and 2045, the impact there. As you're aware, the second piece of that tax rate is what we call the M&O rate, the tax rate that generates revenue for maintenance and operation of your school districts. As you're aware, that tax rate generates tax revenue that then is submitted through the state funding formulas, and those funding formulas ultimately allocate money to the school, both from local and both from state as well. Interestingly, the state formulas are designed to stabilize for variations in tax loss or addition of tax revenue. However, that stabilization doesn't happen for a number of years, for a few years, 2 to 4 years. That's why we see here only a four-year impact. So those formulas are designed to stabilize. However, that first-year impact of $3.9 million isn't a direct result of multiplying your tax rate by your tax base. It is a result of those funding formulas. Again, in Exhibit 3, you have some template runs that our Business and Finance Office have provided to you that works through those formula calculations. Ultimately, we estimate a $15 million impact through those formula calculations through the M&O rate over 4 years. The third impact is the state revenue loss due to students. This is ADA, average daily attendance. We reuse that frequently to talk about the state funding per student. Petitioners indicate that we actually save money by losing students. However, that's based on a budget average per student. This calculation is actually based on the marginal rate from the state per student of a little over $6,000 a student. And that's where this number comes from. The final economic effect is that you have an asset in the community in the village of Diamond Bay. This is the petitioner's Exhibit 4A. As you can see, the affected territory, the village of Diamond Bay, is outlined with this red outline. At the top right-hand corner, you see the property that the district owns. It's approximately 12 acres. Its estimated value is a little over $5.1 million. And it's an asset that you currently own. We'll note that the current capital plan does not include a school on this piece of property. The petitioners referenced the sign that went up on this property advertising a new Fort Bend ISD school. We just want to clarify that once the district learned that sign was up and it was not, we had no intent to build that sign, we took the sign down. We understand that sign was then put back up, we understand, by the developer. And when the district heard of that again, we took it down. Ultimately.
I'm gonna ask the audience not to comment, please. We need to give him the same respect we gave the others. Thank you.
So ultimately, you have property there that's valued at a little over $5.1 million, a district asset. There's your summary of your economic effects. Again, we're looking at this from the large view, the broad forest view of the district as a whole. What's the impact of the loss of this tax base to the district as a whole? Obviously, this results in some budget implications for you. But if you look at this, if you zoom in and look at it from the focused view of the tree itself, you look at it from the impact to the residents of Village of Diamond Bay, as the petitioners increase, the petitioners are seeking higher taxes, effectively. The tax rate in Fort Bend ISD is approximately 7.7 cents lower per valuation than those in Alvin ISD. So when you summarize your economic effects, you see on the left there the kind of focused perspective, increased taxes. Let me remind you, on the increased taxes part, that applies not just to residents who have school-aged children, but it applies to every resident in that affected territory. You then move to the right-hand side here where you are balancing effectively the economic impact to your budget. We move then to the educational interest and effects. We want to start with the focused view. What are the educational interest and effects the Village of Diamond Bay petitioners? We begin, well, we recognize that the petitioners are seeking their desire to provide the best education for their children. As a parent, I understand this. I also would love to be able to stand here as the administration and say that we provide that for those schools in that area, but the reality is that in the affected territory, Alvin ISD schools have outperformed Fort Bend ISD schools. So we understand that and we recognize that. However, these interests and this effect is balanced by several considerations for the educational piece. Specifically referring to class sizes, which are generally smaller in Fort Bend ISD schools, as well as the available capacity. To address the capacity issue presented by the petitioners, we'll note that for the Fort Bend ISD school, she mentioned that Blue Ridge is at 120% capacity. The numbers we have provided is approximately 80% capacity, and I haven't been able to see their information. I would suspect that's due to the to not including the impact of portables, which, as you see, they rely on for their schools as well. Regardless, Fort Bend ISD schools have more available capacity, at least on the elementary level, than the Alvin schools. But this is also balanced against the fact that Fort Bend ISD, due to your investment of resources into our schools, we've seen improvements in these schools. Specifically, this is a chart of the state accountability for these schools. You'll note that in most recent years, every one of these schools, all three, met standard. We recognize that McCulloch and Rilla Ridge in years past have been an improvement required. But again, through your investment of resources into these schools and efforts that we provide, we've seen these improvements come to these schools. So that's the educational interest looking specifically from the petitioner's view, that focused view of the trees, so to speak. You back up and you look at the forest view. What are the educational impacts that this proposed boundary change would have on the students of this district, all 74,000 of them, as a whole? And this is where you see that big budget implication. When you're dealing with an initial $3.9 million hit in year one, that's gonna impact your budget. And we'll recognize that budget decision, those budget decisions, come back to you. And we understand that you will allocate that money in your budget. But we want to highlight some programs that could potentially be impacted by such a financial a loss, including the EDGE program. As you're aware, EDGE is a program that we put high-performing teachers, mentor teachers, and master teachers in schools with a flexible grouping model to provide intensive instruction for these students. The EDGE program is not currently in Blue Ridge, but is in schools to that area. It's a program designed to be expanded. However, when you're facing budget crunches, the expansion of that is an element that could be affected. You also have an instructional coaching initiative where we're trying to put instructional coaches on these campuses, restorative discipline, of course. We also have teachers, specifically McCulloch is one of these schools, that teach only 5 of 7 periods. The intent is to give them that extra planning time. That's an economic factor. And when you're looking at budget decisions, these are all pieces that come into play. And I need to remind you as well regarding staff salaries and or raises. The approximately $4 million is about 1% of your staff salary budget. And so when you start talking raises and a 2% raise, well, that's about twice as much as what we lose from this boundary change. So we're back to the point where we balance these educational interests. We balance on the left again. We balance the focus considerations, the parental desire, Alvin outperformance. We recognize that. But that's balanced with our improvements in those schools, class sizes, capacity. It's also balanced, the large portion here is the budget implications, again, to the district as a whole. We then move to the social effects, third area of our consideration tonight. And we note that when we look at this from the forest view, what are the social effects on the district as a whole? Those are minimal. We note that these students are spread out over several schools, and so the social effects of granting a boundary change would be minimal from that perspective. From the perspective of the Village of Diamond Bay specifically, we recognize that there's a community unity piece to the analysis, and we recognize that, we respect that. However, we note that this community unity piece has existed from the beginning. We note that the inception of this development, that portion of land was already divided. It was in Fort Bend ISD at the inception of the development. And quite honestly, when our petitioners bought their property, they knew or should have known that that property was not only in Fort Bend ISD, but it's interesting to note the county boundary also splits this section of Shadow Creek from the other. The county boundary runs on the same line as the school district boundary. So when you start talking about this community unity piece, it has to be balanced with this recognition that when this property was developed and when property was bought, it was bought with the knowledge of the schools that the students would attend and the district they're a part of. It's also balanced by travel time and distance, and I won't spend a terrible amount of time on this because the petitioners have provided a similar analysis. But what we note is, we essentially note that the distances and the travel time is not that great. The reality is the increase or proposed savings in time is not that great. What this is a chart that we prepared. We use the address in the petition, which happens to be a centrally located address in this Village of Diamond Bay, and we ran a simulation. How long does it take at certain times of day, 8 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, to get to and from school? You'll note the high schools are on the left. You note about a minute and a half difference by car. The largest discrepancy is on the right. You have three elementary schools on the right. You'll note that discrepancy of about 6 minutes one way that you're gaining in travel time by car. The reality is the distances are simply not that great. This is the chart that data is pulled from. And you'll see there on the far right the differences in miles. Again, the social effects are balanced against this idea that the distance and travel time is in reality not that significant. So we summarize those. We finish our social effects. That leads us next into our statutory requirements. We'll note that there are three statutory requirements that the petitioner mentioned that we take no issue with, that we concede. We do want to discuss two of these issues, however. The first of which is the meets and bounds description. As petitioners mentioned, they are required to include a meets and bounds description of the territory. This is a comment from a court case indicating that it's not necessarily a surveyor's notes or legal description that we're looking for, but we're really looking to see, can we identify what property is included to the exclusion of other property? And so in petitioner's exhibit 4A, which they label as their meets and bounds description, we see this statement. We've not included the commercial utility improvement property depicted on the map as we seek detachment and annexation of the residential areas only. So exhibit 4A's, you see the statement that limits the meets and bounds to the residential areas only. On the same page, immediately below that, you have this map. And this map purports to outline, again in the red, the Village of Diamond Bay. You'll note that there are a couple areas excluded, right? We've already seen that Fort Bend ISD's property in the top left-hand corner is excluded, as well as in the bottom right-hand corner, you have this this portion that's also excluded and cut out. But what we want to point out to you is that on this map, there are several pieces of property that are not zoned residential that are included within the boundaries. You have this TH2 labeled property, which I understand is a commercial, some form of commercial related property. You have a recreational piece of property here, which I understand to be a water park. You have a couple of park areas. And then finally, you have a center point utility piece that's actually within the boundary. And then the final piece is this large commercial tract in the bottom left-hand corner. The reality is that they haven't provided to us enough information to determine what actually is included. If we were to vote to approve the petition, would these specific properties be on the Fort Bend ISD tax roll, or would they be on Alvin ISD's tax roll? The answer depends on what piece of their description you look at. If you look at the text, then these properties remain on Fort Bend ISD tax roll. If you look at the map, then they are transferred to Alvin. And so ultimately, when your standard for a meets and bounds description is, we got to identify which property is in and which property is out, we simply don't have that clarity in the petition. This is a requirement that has not been met. The second piece is the ratio requirement that petitioners mentioned. This is the quote from the statute. If detachment would reduce the district's tax base by a ratio at least twice as large as the ratio by which it would reduce its membership. You have two ratios. You have the tax base ratio and the membership ratio. We want to walk through both of those calculations for you. I want you to understand where these ratios are coming from and what they mean. They come from four numbers. You've seen this number before. This is the assessed value of the affected territory, the value that you would lose from the Village of Diamond Bay, from the petition. The assessed value of the district total. You have the students in the affected territory. We'll assume for this point 385. We'll explain why in a moment. Over the students as a whole in the district. These are the four numbers we're going to use to calculate these ratios. We're going to start again with the tax base ratio. Okay, we're going to take the first two numbers. Right, so you take the assessed value of the affected territory. We're going to divide that by the assessed value of the district as a whole, and that gives you this ratio. And you've seen this number, petitioners presented this to you. It's 0.01046. First ratio, this is your outcome. Okay, we'll see that number again in a moment. Shift now to the student ratio. Student ratio, we're going to begin with that 385 number. We'll divide that by the total students in the district, and that gives us our second ratio. Okay? Then the comparison happens. I've just taken for this slide, I've taken those two ratios and repeated them for you so you have them close. Ultimately, the language of the statute says that this petition is prohibited if the tax base ratio is at least twice as large as the membership ratio. So to calculate that, what we're going to do is we're going to double that membership ratio. And now we compare. If you look at the two highlighted numbers, again, the petition is prohibited if the tax base ratio, the number at the top, is at least twice as large as the membership ratio. The top number is larger than the membership ratio. Therefore, we fail the ratio test. Pause and give you a moment to kind of process and see where we are. This is 385 students. I'll note, if we bump this up to 386, I want you to see what happens. We change it to 386. Your ratio, that top ratio is the same. The membership ratio has increased by a small amount. I want you to see what happens. When you increase to 386, now the bottom number is larger. And we pass the ratio test. The important thing is, I want you to see that 386 students is the tipping point. Okay? That if there's 386 students in this area, then the petitioners pass the test. If there's anything less than 386, then we fail the test. The reason we're using 385 and 386, and we're kind of walking through this backwards, is that because the Commissioner of Education has determined in Floresville ISD v. Wilson County, it's a Commissioner of Education case from 1989 addressing this ratio, that the students you use, the student count you use, are the number of public school students residing in the territory. Those students who attend homeschool or private school are not included in this calculation. And the reason is the calculation is designed to show it's designed to prevent a disproportionate loss of tax base when compared to the loss of students, right? So the loss of public school students. And it's a bit difficult to track this number down when you talk about the number of public school students. We know that in Fort Bend ISD, we have 74 students that live in the affected territory that attend Fort Bend ISD. We also know from Alvin ISD, there's 26 students in the territory. We know that there's 20 that attend Pearland ISD. That gives us a total of 120. Keep in mind, 386 is your tipping point. We recognize that there may be other students that live in that area that attend another ISD, another public school. For example, Houston ISD, Pasadena ISD, you've got some other various ISD. The reality is we don't know that number. But it's reasonable to conclude that that number of students in this territory is not 266 or greater. Therefore, we see that because that tipping point is 386, that they cannot pass the ratio test. I'll point out that petitioner's numbers, as you review those in the chart, note that they are based on total school age children in the territory. But that's not what we're looking at. According to the commissioner, we're looking at public school students. There's your difference. Incidentally, if you run the ratio requirement test for 120 students, you'll see that that bottom number there is nowhere close to exceeding the top number. The legislature put this provision in to prevent a grossly disproportionate loss in tax base compared to student membership. We don't meet the test here tonight. So to conclude, to summarize, we've seen the economic effects. You've heard the numbers, the debt service impact. You've seen the M&O rate impact through the state revenue. You've also seen the property as well as ADA impact from student numbers. You've seen the educational effects, the social effects, and then ultimately you've seen the statutory requirements that ultimately prohibit this petition for detachment and annexation. So board, I want to reiterate the administration's recommendation. And on the basis of the information presented, the administration recommends that you adopt a resolution that disapproves this petition for detachment and annexation. Trustees, I appreciate your time. I appreciate your preparation as well as your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilbanks. Now is the time for the Board of Trustees to ask questions if we have any. Do any of the board members have questions for the parties at this time? Okay, then we will proceed with the next portion of our hearing, which is public comment. Did you have something? I only have. Do we have a question from Mrs. James?
Yeah, I'll ask a question. So I'd like to ask a clarifying question on the boundaries. I don't have a copy of your slides, and I don't know where to look in the information you sent us to show the map or see it in a way that I can actually see it. So is this the map?
This is it.
Is this the map that you provided us?
Yes.
Okay. And so these little cutouts here are meant to be here? Around the property that we own and around?
Yes. So what you're referencing, and I do want to rebut what Mr. Wilbanks said, if you look at the top, TH2, is actually a subdivision. This map was drawn at the beginning of the process when the neighborhood was established. So TH3 is actually Crystal Cove right now. That is TH2 is actually a residential neighborhood.
I think we're looking at SCH6 is cut out, as well as the bottom corner.
It's kind of black and white striped section.
That one's not in there.
Because that's a commercial property.
Mm-hmm.
That was, it's actually a utility property. So that's why it was cut out. We only included residential areas, which you would see outlined. As far as the school, we were under the impression that that particular piece of land was gifted to Fort Bend ISD by the developer. And if we were approved, then that land would be gifted back to Alvin ISD. So that's why I was not included in the meets and bounds.
Okay. What is the basis of that understanding?
Discussions with the developer. That's our understanding.
Okay, I have one additional question of petitioners. The numbers that you guys used to conduct the ratio were significantly different. May I ask, why did you choose to use, I don't have your slides in front of me, so I don't remember the numbers. Why did you choose to use the 600 student number, and what evidence do you have that that is the correct number?
Based on our door-to-door petition signature collection, we identified 353 homes that had 651 students. Of those 651 children, 353 of those were school age, so that yielded a 54% school age children.
Can you repeat the number? Was it 350 were school age children?
That was just based on a sample of 353 homes. So we did an extrapolation based on the 1380 homes, and that 48% of all of Village of Diamond Bay homes have children, and then that 54% of those homes, 54% of those students would be school age, and arrived at the 600. And then to further validate that, PASA demographics had a 0.6 and a 0.58 ratio that they would use per students per home, and they arrived at a 600 amount until they decided that we were more equivalent of a retirement community and used 0.3, which still would yield 400 students and would cause us to meet the ratio.
These are total school age students, not necessarily students in public schools.
Yes, and the code states, the second ratio is determined by dividing the number of students residing in the affected territory by the number of students residing in the district as a whole.
Thank you.
It does not differentiate public school versus private versus homeschool.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're gonna move on to the public comment portion of our hearing. I have 12 speakers signed up in favor and 0 speakers signed up opposed. So given that we have no speakers signed up opposed, we were to allow 30 minutes per side. We will allow all 12 speakers to speak, 3 minutes apiece. Ms. Helliger will keep the time and will give a 30-second warning. We will ask you to step forward and use one of the two microphones that are here for public speakers. When I call your name, please come forward. Tammy Norris. You have 3 minutes, thank you.
Hi, I don't think it's on. Is it on? Okay, I'm just short. Okay. My name is Tammy Norris. I am a resident of Diamond Bay, and I have a 6-year-old and a 4-year-old right there that are affected by this decision that y'all will be making tonight. Oh, thanks. Okay, the dream for my family. Moving to Shadow Creek Ranch, we were excited to start our family in an environment where our children could have lifelong friends and classmates. The dream of this was high as we met our neighbors that had the same age groups as our kids. Our kids could walk and ride to bikes to school and have normal school life that many of us as adults experienced as kids. We moved from LaPorte ISD for the sole purpose of schools and the education that their children would experience. The dream was so real. In Shadow Creek Ranch, there are great schools that we were going to get top awards. In addition, these schools were within walking, bike riding distance from our house. We signed the papers and bought this dream. Shortly after we moved, we met our neighbors who had kids of the same age. God could not have put us in a better neighborhood. The dream of lifelong friends that would grow up together was tangible. There are enough kids that a solid 10 on any given day within our little street could ride or walk the same age group together. It was amazing. As friendships developed and memories were made, the topic of schools came up. That was when the dream was crushed. We later discovered that Rhineland Homes purposely sold us our house. They drove us around in their sales car and showed us, this is York Elementary, this is Wilder. We're not quite sure where you're located and where you're going to, but these are the schools within our community. It's a brick-walled community. You would assume that the builder that's driving you around, showing you the school, we were one of the people that was misinformed. Yes, it was very dumb on me to not truly look it up and go based off the maps and everything that we were given by Rhineland Homes. There was great disbelief when we found out the elementary school that our kids were assigned to. We literally had to drive across railroad tracks. How far? 4.5 miles down McCard Road? Past the neighborhood with bars on the windows? Wait a second, this is not what I signed up when I moved to Shadow Creek Ranch. After talking to neighbors who experienced the same thing, we realized we had to start looking at our options. We had four options. Option one, apply for a transfer to Fort Bend ISD school. Option two, apply for an inter-district transfer to Pearland ISD school. But there was no guarantee that every year that you would get this. The third was use false address so your kids could go to a Shadow Creek Ranch school, which I don't believe in lying. Four was private school from K through 12. Currently, my kid is in private school. We're spending $9,600 a year for her to go to Heritage Christian, which is located in Shadow Creek Ranch, so that she can go with kids in her school year. When we have two kids, we're pushing almost $20,000 just for her to lie there. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Miss Mary Matyarova? Did I say that correctly? Thank you. You have 3 minutes.
Yeah, hello. My name is Maria Madyarova. I live in Diamond Bay, Shadow Creek, and I just wanted to show you that, for example, I have a bachelor's degree in mathematics. My husband, too. He has a PhD in civil engineering department. I have a master's degree in civil engineering department. So education is highly important to us. So we moved to Shadow Creek Ranch. We didn't know what exactly school we are going to go to. We had just 18 months old baby. We live in Shadow Creek since 2007. So then we figured out that our schools that we are assigned to are actually low-performed schools. So we decided to go to private schools. Right now, my daughter, she is 10 years old. She goes to middle school. My second daughter, she is 7 years old. She goes to Silver Line Montessori Elementary School. It is a private school. My older daughter, she goes to village school. That's also private school. I have also 18 months son. And I can tell you that my paying for to my daughters, we spend actually $40,000 a year. And we also have 18 months old baby that we also put to Candyland school, but it is not a public school, it is just a school that for babies. And so you can see that we spent around $50,000 just for schools for our children. Since we are just engineers, me and my husband, so we don't have really high income. Our children, for example, asking to have a pool in the house and so on, but we cannot afford it. We just want them to go to schools and have a good education, and we are willing to pay such amount of money just for them to get the education at least that we got with my husband. So I really wanted you to show that many parents who live in Diamond Bay community, they go to private schools, pay a lot of money, and actually maybe many of them don't even have that money. Maybe they don't want even to pay that money. And if you ask me, do I want to pay my taxes to Fort Bend ISD schools that I don't want to go to, I can tell you that I don't want to do it. I would like to go to Alvin schools if I can. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Chad Greenfield.
Sorry, I'm short too.
You have 3 minutes.
Thank you. My name is Chad Greenfield. I also live in the village of Diamond Bay. I would just like to point out that before I start that the district's presentation, kind of their whole point was all shucks. You know, your students have to go to schools that are low performing, and we understand that. But since you decided that that's not acceptable, we're not going to count them when it comes into the census because you're doing something else to better your students' education. So I just wanted to point that out. I had a letter that I have submitted to you guys that outlines all the numbers. We don't need to do that. The district has already admitted that these schools that we're zoned to are very low performing. If our students need to transfer, it only adds to the burden of trying to get those children to school. But I'd like to point out that they said there would be no social impact whatsoever. Our students aren't able to be involved in the Fort Bend ISD activities, not only because of location, but they all live in the city of Pearland. Everything is either in the city of Missouri City, or if we have to get farther to get to school, it's all the way into Sugar Land. There is no community pride. There is nothing like that. I grew up in a small town. We had a solid high school, and the activities that revolved around that high school did nothing but give the entire community pride. You know, Fridays when it was a football game or we were sending students off to state academic competitions, people are lining the streets, you know, cheering them on. Nothing does a student better than seeing their community support them and knowing that people are proud of them. That will go way farther than anything else. I just find it kind of laughable that we can just sit here and say, well, I mean, I'm sorry that your students are having to go to schools where they're having to worry about getting beat up or they're having to worry about going to an F-rated school. I mean, we're trying, but these schools have been low performing for decades. It's not just the last years. And the MET standard, just because there's a standard MET doesn't mean it's acceptable. And so I would highly recommend you to think about where you would want your children or your grandchildren to go. And if you are okay with them going to those schools, I would love for them to be alongside my school, my kid in those schools next year. I'd love to see them. I'd love to be on the PTA with you. Maybe at that point something would get changed. But unfortunately, it seems like those schools are just forgotten about. Thank you.
30 seconds. Okay.
Thank you for being here. I have two signed up, Charlemagne and Carl Williams. Which one of you would like to speak? Williams, Ms. Carl Williams? Okay, we'll set that aside. Adriana Mesa? You have 3 minutes.
Good evening. My name is Adriana Mesa. I'm an administrator in HISD, and first I wanted to clarify one thing. My son Ricky is 8 years old, and he attends Blue Ridge Elementary, and he's not a tree. He's not a tree in your forest. Ricky is a human being. He's a human being who deserves a great education, and in fact, I am a product of Fort Bend ISD. I am Walker Station, Satarsha Middle School, and Austin High School. I am so proud of that education that Fort Bend gave me. But that education is not the same one that my son is receiving at all, by any means. And I can say that as the first parent to speak, as a Blue Ridge parent, is Principal Welker here tonight? Is the principal of the school that we're talking about here tonight? She's not. Why? That's what I don't understand. We're talking about these important issues. We're talking about our kids. We're not talking about trees and forests. We're talking about my son. Okay? So what I want to say, and I don't view you guys as the bad guys tonight, because you're with me. I'm an educator in a Title I school. I'm an administrator in a Title I school. I know the struggles we face. But every day, we do two things. One, our schools serve our communities. That's what they do. Two, we do what's right for kids. I'm going to say that one more time. We do what's right for kids. Okay? And so, Blue Ridge, I will not speak ill of the teachers. They are trying their hardest. I want to put it out there. Miss Mary Edwards has showed my child, adopted from foster care, so much love. So much love. They are great teachers, but they're fighting a losing battle in Blue Ridge. And they're serving the community that they have, but we're not that community. We're a different community. They're serving their community. They're structuring their master schedule around their community. They have Power 30 in their classroom every single day. Interventions for students who aren't reading on level. My student is reading on level. He's reading above grade level. He's being ignored for 30 minutes a day as teachers give individualized instruction to struggling students. That's not my baby. That's not our babies. My child deserves the education that I got from Fort Bend ISD. And tonight, I was hoping, I was praying, I had my fingers crossed that you'd have some solution. We're going to build an elementary school for you. We're going to do something. And I didn't hear that. And it breaks my heart that the school district that served me so well, that, you know, took the child of two immigrants, sent her to college, and made me into who I am, is not able to do the same thing for my son. So he's not a tree.
30 seconds.
He's a human being. And I hope you can see that tonight.
Thank you for being here. Sarum Ean, am I saying that correctly? Sarum. You have 3 minutes.
Hi, my name is Sarum Ean, and I'm a resident of Shadow Creek Ranch at the Village of Diamond Bay. I have 2 children, ages 4 and 2 and a half. I am speaking in support of the detachment of our section from Fort Bend ISD to Alvin ISD. When my husband and I purchased our first home, we were a fresh out of college, and school districts were low on the deciding factor of where to purchase. We were just excited to be new homeowners, and we ended up purchasing in Houston ISD. 6 years later, we had our first child and immediately started researching new homes and communities. We purchased in Shadow Creek because of its diversity and its amazing community for families. Years have passed, and there are still no plans for elementary school within our section of Shadow Creek. It is disheartening to see more and more neighbors move and children being shuffled to all parts of Houston and its surrounding areas to attend school. To address any comments or misperceptions that there is any relations to race, diversity is not black and white, no pun intended. Take a look at the table of representatives of our sections, of which I am a team member of. That is diversity. Shadow Creek and our village represents all races, ages, and genders, and sexual orientations. As a double minority, I appreciate the diversity of my neighborhood, and you should too. We also wanted to take the time and say thank you to our neighbors who have volunteered their time, this past year, those who have signed the petition, emailed, or wrote letters to members of the Fort Bend ISD trustees or even Alvin trustees, or communicated to members of the city council. Your communications have already made a difference based on the approved resolution from the City of Pearland City Council members.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Raul Zayas.
Good night, everybody. My name's Raul Sayas. You have already met my my wife. She's my better half, Heather Sayas. She's part of the petitioners. Heather and I have a young kid. He's 4 and a half years old, and he's getting ready to attend kindergarten. Before I start, I'm not a really good public speaker, but I want to tell you I would do anything for that kid. I would do anything that I can. Anything in my power to make sure that he receives the best education possible. And we thought we were getting that opportunity when we moved to Shadow Creek, to our neighborhood. We were told originally that we could attend the schools within our community, and that was not the case. Originally, Yalvin ISD had allowed our residents to attend their schools, but at later years, they stopped that practice. In addition, for a good 4 years, we kept on seeing the sign of Fort Bend ISD advertising a new school that was going to go in at the corner of 2234 and Trinity Bay. That hasn't happened. That sign, it was sitting there for a good 4 years. That we've been in the neighborhood 8 years, and now that sign is gone. The taxpayers of our neighborhood have paid into Fort Bend for many years now, and not only isn't there a school, but the schooling options being provided are significantly far from our neighborhood, and most importantly, they are consistently below state standards. Not only do we want our children to have the best education possible, but we want our community children to have the best education possible. So we're talking about the entire community, not only our family. We have schools a mile away that are great schools, and we are not able to send our children to those schools. And that's basically the purpose of this meeting that we have here. These lines that were dividing the counties were originally arbitrary lines made when the properties over there were cow fields, and by coincidence, the line runs right across my backyard. So, if I could move the house 10 feet, I would probably be in the Alvin side, but I'm not. Anyway, we just wanted to say that looking at the numbers, we can look at the numbers all night, and at 1%, looking at that 1%, that's not a whole lot, but most important is, what we do
Thank
with
you.
Our
Your
children
time is
and
up.
The education we provide them. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. And Mr. Rodrigo Carrion.
My name is Rodrigo Carrion. I live on the east side of Fort Bend on 521, and came to find out and see what the issue was going to be on this tax rate revenue, which is a problem to all our school districts. And I was coming to support this petition because of concern of safety problems relating on 521 and 2234, which is a lot of construction going to take place. There is going to be a railroad overpass, and to me it looks like more traffic or difficult for our school buses to transfer these students to Blue Ridge, Willow Ridge, or Crystal McCullough. And I don't know how long it's going to take for them to start that, but it will happen. And the thing is, to me it was to keep this community united in one place, and for the students to be able to walk to their own school and school district, and prohibit them from risking more lives on the road with dangerous traffic. There is going to be a lot of traffic taking place right there in 521 and 2234. And what is this? So if this petition doesn't go through, what's going to take the public's vote and voters to get on vote for new state revenue to come in, for new state leadership, and to bring in revenue to all our school districts, which is behind, the state of Texas behind under 48. But only voters' voice will make a difference. And so I recommend all the public to take it seriously and get out and vote for our November and future May elections to get this job done and make sure our schools have the proper fundings to bring in the proper education all our schools needs. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carrion. Michael Richmond.
My name is Michael Richmond, and I live in the village of Diamond Bay as well. I have four daughters, three of them school age. They attend McCullough, Blue Ridge, and Willow Ridge. And I just want to just give an idea of the things that I've some of the things that I've experienced since I've lived in Shadow Creek. And having to deal with Fort Bend County. So I have a you know, a letter that I like to read or some information I like to give you. Okay, one of the reasons that I moved to this subdivision was to give my kids a better opportunity regarding community and education. Unfortunately, I have experienced issues with Fort Bend County from day one since I've been here. For instance, on the first day of school for the 2015-16 year, my oldest daughter was required to wait for a school bus hired by Fort Bend ISD to pick her up. It was called Gold Star Transit. My daughter was at the bus stop at the scheduled time, but had to wait with other students over 45 minutes before the bus arrived. The bus never showed up. Eventually, one of the students left and she walked away and she told us, Fort Bend County always treats the students of the community this way. I waited for another 2 minutes or so and decided to call the transportation terminal to find out why the bus never showed up. An employee named May Haynes answered the phone and asked me a series of questions regarding the community I lived in. Then I was asked to hold on. This took approximately 15 minutes and she never came back to the phone. I then called back and someone else answered the phone, put me on hold again. I had to wait, they never came back. The department was very unprofessional, lacked customer service, and seemed unconcerned regarding the circumstances experienced by my daughter. I called back and at this time the phone was automatically sent to a voicemail. I tried to call back for the next 30 minutes, same result. By this time I had to get dressed for work. I had to, because the bus didn't show up, I had to take my daughter to school and it caused me to be late for my job. Okay, I called Miss Laurie Albright and she told me that she would investigate and give me a call back that morning. Well, that call never came. Later that afternoon, I got a call from my daughter telling me that, what's that?
30 seconds.
Okay, I got a call from my daughter telling me that the school bus never picked her up. So I had to rush and leave my job and go get her. And but I just want to say that there really needs to be a rezoning of our community. I say that because the distance for my child to walk to school is just too far for. And she lives in our community, and this is just a weird setup for her.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for being here, Mr. Barry Martin.
Barry Martin. I just want to say that looking at the two, I guess, the two communications or the two presentations today, I think it's pretty obvious that there's a huge discrepancy between the school districts that we're zoned to and the school districts that we should be zoned to. Just seems that the district is interested in our money and not our kids. There was mention of, the $4 million loss first year. There was also mention of a $5 million property that could cover that should have been zoned for our schools, which sure enticed half of the people here to buy in this area. It just seems that there's no interest in equality as far as the neighborhoods go. And I guess the education that one set of students or one set of kids that live in this area receive as opposed to the other set. The fact that most of the community has their kids in private school says a lot about what we're willing to do for our kids and what we expect for our kids, and we're not receiving that. They mentioned how much they make from us based on taxes a year. I've lived in the community 8 or 9 years, no improvements on any of the schools that we're zoned to. Where's the tax money going? It's just not a logical option, in my opinion, just the fact that we're even having this conversation. Who leaves their community to go to a school just because they're zoned? We should be zoned in our community, Alvin, where there's 5, 6 brand new schools within walking distance, within biking distance, within driving distance. And that's all I got to say.
Thank you for being here. Puneet Gupta?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Puneet Gupta, and I'm a resident of Diamond Bay Village. One thing I want to point to my friend, attorney from Fort Bend, he said, look at the green tree, focus on the tree. But if the root of the trees are weak, how that tree will survive? Tell me, I'm asking this question, those schools, Blue Ridge, McAuliffe, we don't have any standard as per what I noticed. I have two kids, one daughter which goes to middle school and the son who is going to first grade. So the first year when I moved in, I sent my daughter to Blue Ridge School and I saw the quality. She was getting A grades, but she doesn't bring any homework to school. When I say, hey, what are you doing? Oh, we did the homework in school. I ask her, hey, what are you learning? Oh, we just play in the classrooms. So that kind of thing, when I see, I talk to the teachers, no results. Then the next year, I have to send her to different ISD because Pearland ISD was taking transfers. So, and then I saw the difference between those two schools. Even she was getting grades in Pearland ISD, straight A's. Now she asked me questions, how to do this? And you can see I'm an immigrant. Education is the base since I'm here. I'm here only based on education. I myself is a master's. My wife is also having a master's degree in science. And that's what we think, like our children should get the same education what we have. And education is the only key they can keep throughout their life. If they don't get the chance to explore the education in their early childhood, they are not going to learn things which will make them good citizens in future. So look at me, like I have to drive 20 miles daily because due to the ISD transfer, they don't provide transportation. I have to go to Sam Jamieson daily in the morning and my wife picks up. It takes like 2 hours of our life in just commute due to the traffic. I have to send my son to a private school. It cost us a lot. And if we are paying already so much taxes, I'm willing, and I can assure you all of our neighbors are willing to pay higher rates for Alvin ISD. And here, I'm requesting you guys to please approve this annexure so that our kids get quality of education, what they have right to. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Lena Jones.
Yes, my name is Lena Jones, and I am a resident of the village of Diamond Bay. I have with me my grandson, whom I dearly love. I have my bachelor's degree. My husband has a postgraduate degree. My sons and my daughters all have college degrees, and we in our household value education very much. We moved to the village of Diamond Bay in 2009, early. We were told that we would go to the schools that were in the district. We also were shown the village of Diamond Bay's the sign for the Fort Bend ISD on Trinity Bay as we come in. That sign has been there since 2009 when we moved in, and heaven knows how long before that. So I find it sort of ironic that the sign which came down only last year was only discovered by the Fort Bend ISD last year. It's been there at least since 2009. I can guarantee that, and I'm sure many other people here can guarantee that. Now, because of the condition of the schools that are zoned to our district, to our area, we have to pay for our grandson to go to a private school, even though we are paying taxes in Fort Bend ISD. The board member representative said that the social impact was minimal, and he counted that as only the travel distance involved. That is not the sum total of the social impact. The social impact is to our children, to their future. When they do not get a good foundation, it follows them all through their lives. Not only that, we do not feel as part of the rest of our community. We are totally alienated from the other parts of the community that are served by the Fort Bend ISD. We have no connection to the communities that are over there. And if our children are not allowed to take part in any extracurricular activities, there is no sense of belonging. They play with kids at the pool.
30 seconds.
That, you know, they don't see in their school area. It's just not acceptable. And really, I found the whole analogy between the trees and the forest so insulting. I really, really found that very, very insulting. It's not only about the money. It seems as though, you know, you're saying, look at what it does to the rest of the Fort Bend ISD. What about our children? Those are our main concern.
Thank you for being here. Has Mr. or Mrs. Williams arrived? Okay, that concludes the public comment portion of the hearing. Before we go into closing arguments, did you have the question? Mrs. James, you had the question?
I can ask.
Yeah, go ahead.
I have one question for the administration. And this has to do with the feeder patterns of the schools that these folks are zoned to. Does all of Blue Ridge Elementary go to McCullough Middle School, and in turn, does all of McCullough Middle School go to Willow Ridge High School?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. One last comment I want to make. I would like to ask the administration to provide the board members with a copy of the commissioner's opinion that you referenced, in addition to any contrary or conflicting opinions that might be out there. Thank you. So now we will go into closing arguments by each side. Each side will receive 5 minutes for closing argument. Ms. Helliger, again, will keep the time and will give a 30-second warning. We will start with the petitioners.
Good evening again. First, we wanted to just rebut a few things again. That $21 million unfunded debt assumes that it would not be replaced by new development within Fort Bend ISD. And then also, during our petition signature collections, we were very clear that the tax rate would increase, and all residents, including retirees and residents without children, gladly signed the petition. And as far as the property at the corner of 2234 and Trinity Bay that is owned by FBISD, if that sign was on your property and you own it, you're responsible for the items that are on your property. And we have had residents call, and we received conflicting information from representatives of administration when we would call about whether a school would be built. They would say, yes, there's going to be a school going to be built. Yes, it's included in the bond that was just voted on. So we would receive varying information related to that. And as far as the travel time presented in the administration's presentation, 70% of the students who travel to FBISD schools travel by bus, and that is at least an hour commute daily, which is 5 to 6 hours per week. So in conclusion, we have demonstrated that we have met the legal requirements to be detached from Fort Bend ISD. We have communicated that the social, educational, and economic aspects highlight the necessity that we be detached from Fort Bend ISD. Young families chose to move into the village of Diamond Bay because it seemed very probable that a school would be built before our children would reach school age. I actually made the conscious decision to move into the FBISD zone side of Shadow Creek Ranch. I wanted my kids to attend Fort Bend ISD schools. I was excited about the prospect of a new school in our community. But as the years passed, I was thoroughly disappointed and disheartened as the district chose to ignore our community and to ignore the needs of the students who attend the schools to which we are zoned. I was fully prepared to send my son to Blue Ridge Elementary, but how can I when it seems that Fort Bend ISD has turned its back on the students and the communities that are at the eastern edge of their district and continue to focus on the south and the western communities? I urge you to do what is right and is fair for our children and the children of our community. Ask yourselves, if it was your child or your grandchild sitting here, what would you want the school board to do? We can sit here all night and debate and talk about ratios and figures and money and debate funds and how long it'll take to make back money and how much the kid and money and debt funds and how long it will take the money back. But right now is a time that we can do something and do what's right for the kids in our community. To do for our children what you would want someone to do for yours if you were standing here in our place. So I urge you to make the decision about the children. Thank you.
Thank you. Now the administration will have 5 minutes for closing argument.
Thank you, Madam President. I want to make two clarifying remarks. Number one, we want to point out that the statutory requirements tonight have not been met. That's a piece that we want you to look at clearly. That's a piece that, quite honestly, as the administration, we don't have a lot of discretion over. Number two, we want to point out we've been able to secure some information regarding extracurriculars at Blue Ridge, and we can provide that additional information to you. We want to point out that there are extracurricular opportunities available for those students there, and I don't believe that was made clear tonight, so we want to point that out to you. Some of those opportunities include dance, cheer, honor choir, Eagle Club, symphony, and et cetera. We want to make that clear to you. The final piece that we want to...
I'm going to ask the audience, please, one more time, let's be respectful of the speaker, please.
To conclude, Board, we understand... Let me start with this. To you residents from the village of Diamond Bay, I understand your mothers, I understand your fathers and grandparents of children in our district. I understand that, and I thank you for your passion. I thank you for your efforts and for your attendance. And I know that that may ring hollow at this moment, but I simply want to communicate, Board, that that passion, that those comments, weigh heavily on the administration. I want you to hear that those comments that urge education is key ring very strongly to us. We are in this business because of education. The comment regarding students are humans and not trees, and to the extent that analogy was inappropriate, I apologize. I want to point out, however, that there's a forest full of 74,000 other students in this district that warrant equal passion, warrant equal consideration, warrant the consideration. That's why the administration put the presentation to you in the form that it did. We want to give valid consideration to the Village of Diamond Bay arguments, but we also at the same time want to give valid consideration to the remainder of our community, the remainder of our district as a whole. So to conclude, we simply want to reiterate that we're here for children. We're here for the kids, for the 74,000 students in your district, and that's the reason. We can put numbers up on a screen, but the reason is ultimately the administration feels that this is in the best interest of all 74,000 students in your district and all of your residents across the district. So, Board, we thank you for your time. and your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Wilbanks. The presentations and public comments are now complete, so the board will now adjourn to receive advice of the board council and to deliberate in private. We are now convened in closed session.